Okay, hello. Welcome, everybody. Ralph Strainen is here to talk about EDOS and what's new, what's the future, and see what he has to say.
Okay, better? Yeah. All right. So I would like to tell you something about the things we have been doing recently in our research group. I've put EDOS in the title. Well, it isn't called EDOS any longer for some time now, but I will come back to that a bit later. So first of all, this is joint work. There have been more people involved in this. And this work has been done with these three fine gentlemen. Pietro was already mentioned in the talk by Wookie. He is the main author of our library and of our tools. Roberto Di Cosmo, he was behind the two European research projects that we had, and he is the founder and leader of the eRail Research Lab, where I'm currently working in Paris. And of course, everybody knows Zach, our beloved Debian project leader, who has also been participating in this research. Okay, so. This is the starting point. I won't talk much about this because this is things we have presented a lot of times and at FOSDEM, at DevConf, and so on. Just as a quick reminder, so our starting point is what we have been doing some 5 or 6 years ago, and this gave us a tool which is today called EDOS DevCheck. What does it do? Well, it takes a package repository, like the packages file that you find on your favorite Debian mirror, and it looks just on the relations between binary packages, dependencies, conflicts, provides, and so on. And it tells you for each of the packages in this repository whether the package is in theory installable. That is, whether it is possible to satisfy all the dependencies and conflicts with packages that are present in this repository. It does this by looking only at the metadata. It does not try to install anything. It does not look at maintainer scripts. It does not look at code at all. It just looks at the package relations. However, it uses a complete solving algorithm, and this is one of the main features that distinguishes it from aptitude or from apt, because it uses, in fact, a Z-solver, which is behind and which actually finds a solution every time a solution is theoretically possible. And we have a fast implementation behind this, which comes in several flavors. One flavor is for Debian, another one is for RPM, and in fact, we have today a generic tool called EDOS DistCheck, which also works for different related component models like OSGI plugins. Okay, so why did we continue to work on this? Because this is something we have been doing some 5 or 6 years ago. Well, this gives part of the answer. In fact, we are running our tool on the Debian distribution for all the architectures and for all the areas every day. And then you get out of it something like this. This is the table of the results we get for each of the days. So the lines are the different days, columns are the different architectures. This is only a part of the results, and in fact, it's a bit old. It's from September 2011. In fact, when you look at the figures of today, it's much, much better. This is probably an effect of the freeze. So packages are much more better behaved today. So we see here, for instance, for Intel, some 400 packages which are not installable. For AMD, also some 400. And for the less popular architecture, it's even more packages which are not installable. And the problem is, well, if you would click on this figure here, you would get a table of all the packages which are found not to be installable with an explanation why these packages are not installable. Well, the problem with this is, imagine that you would try to start filing bug reports or problem reports based on this, it's just too much. There are too many not installable packages, so before one wants to do something with this data, one has to look more precisely why it happens at all that packages are not installable, and you have to ask yourself the question whether we at all should worry about these packages which are not installable. So why might it happen that the package is not installable in Zit? But there are some easy cases. One easy case is quite obvious. It might be a transient problem, which is just due to the fact that the maintainer has uploaded a package and all its dependencies are not yet available for this architecture. In this case, the problem will just go away in a day or two. Nothing to worry about, and these cases can be found very, very easily just by looking at the age of the problem report, which is found by our tool. A second source of non-installable packages which we do not have to worry about is this one. We have architecture all packages, and with our current infrastructure, these packages will be propagated into all the architecture packages files. And it may happen that, in fact, these architecture all packages are intended only for some architectures. And in this case, usually it happens that its dependencies, which are architecture specific, may just not be available, and in this case we find architecture all packages which are not installable on some of the architectures. Nothing to worry about, and in, again, this can be filtered out quite easily just by looking at the architecture file of the binary packages. However, there are other cases which are not so easy. And some of these might be cases where we can say, where we can pinpoint a location where something has to be done. And these cases are, well, it might be the case that the package P depends, for instance, on some non-installable packages, or that it depends on packages which are in conflict with each other at the moment. And then the question, well, first of all, we would, in this case, if this happens, our tool would report a package P to be not installable, because this is just the claim to fame of this tool, that it does a deep analysis of all the possibilities to install a package, and it would find out a problem if a problem happens. Now, well, in this case, it might be the fault of the package P, or it might be the fault of one of the packages that P depends on. And this is what we would like to find out. It would be very nice to have a tool which could tell us in such a situation, well, now we have a package P which is found to be not installable, who is to blame? Who has to work on his package and fix something in order to make it installable again? Well, this is what we would like to have, ideally. However, this is, of course, a goal which in this way cannot be solved by an automatic tool. Of course not. Because if we would like to find out who is to blame, then we would need some understanding why there is a certain dependency, why there is a certain conflict, and how these can possibly be changed in order to make the package work again. An automatic tool which just looks at the dependencies cannot solve this. Only a human could do that. Maybe we could do it with machine learning, but this is something which we are not doing at the moment. However, what we can do is we can, in a subset of these problems, pinpoint the situation where there is a package, and it is precisely this package which has to be fixed. No one else can do anything about it. And this is the situation that we would like to detect. And first of all, I will give you a precise definition what this means. This precise definition is completely theoretical. It's not effective. And then I will try to explain you how this definition can be turned into something which can be recognized effectively by an automatic tool. Okay, and this is the idea. So when I talk about PN, this means that I have a package with a name, P, and a certain version, which is N. And I'm looking at a situation that I have such a package, PN, which is not installable with respect to the current repository, which I call capital R. Now, the situation where I can say, well, it is P's own fault not to be installable is the following situation. No matter what all the other packages in the repository do, if they move on to newer versions, if they change their dependencies, they change their provides, they change their conflicts, whatever, no matter what all the other packages do, this package remains not installable. If this is the case, then I call my package outdated. So this is our definition of outdated, because then I know that this package, it is not installable, and only this package itself can do something about it and can fix its dependencies, conflicts, in order to become installable again. So why does this make sense? Well, this makes sense, of course, only because we may have dependencies and conflicts with version constraints. And this you will see in a second, and the examples. Okay, here are some examples. These are artificial examples, but at the end of the talk, you will see some examples that I got out of my tool. Well, first of all, this is an example where we are just looking at the question whether a certain package is installable at all, and in the next slide we will look at the question whether it is outdated, in fact. So what do we have? We have here a dependency. Package foo version 1 has a dependency which consists of two alternatives, and in fact when you look at this for a few seconds you will see that this, of course, is, well, in fact, it's quite obvious that this package is not installable. Why? Well, we have a first dependency, which is either bas in version 2.5 or bar in version precisely 2.3. and we have none of them in the repository. So we have bar in version 2, bass in version 2 again, and this is of course not satisfiable at the moment. So in this case, we would find that package foo in version 1 is not installable. Now, for precisely the same set of packages, is foo 1 also outdated? And the answer is no, it's not. Why not? Because, well, even if foo 1 is currently not installable, what may happen is that, for instance, bar is advancing its version to version 2.3. So this would satisfy this dependency. And bass, say, is advancing to some version which is greater than 2, but, well, in fact, it's not necessary. So bass can remain at the current version, just the package bar has to advance to version 2.3 in order to make it installable. So in this case, the package is not outdated. Now let's look at this package file, which is slightly changed. In fact, what has changed here are just the version numbers and the conflict. And here we now have a case of a package foo, which is in fact outdated. It can only be fixed by changing the dependencies of the package foo itself. No matter what the other packages bar and bass are doing, they cannot make this package with these dependencies installable. Why? Okay, look at the first line. Here you need bass of version 2.5 or bar of version 2.3. Okay, imagine you try to have bass of version 2.5. Bass of version 2.5, it's already here, that's fine. However, when we have bass of version 2.5, we cannot have at the same moment bass of a what's happening here? Did I mess up the? Okay, yes, of course. Yeah, thanks. So because we have already version 2.5, we cannot have this dependency satisfied. So we have to satisfy this one, bar greater than 2.6, which is in conflict to what we have here. So this is not possible. However, if we say we satisfy the first line by bar in version 2.3, which is already here, then we cannot satisfy this one. So we have to satisfy this one, and this is not possible because we are already at version 2.5. We cannot downgrade this package in the repository. So this is the kind of analysis that we would like to do automatically with our tool. All right, so now I've given you some intuition. In order to make it more precise, you have, of course, to define what precisely it means to move from one repository to a future version. What precisely may happen when you move on packages in your repository. So what may happen? Packages may be removed. Packages may move to newer versions, but they cannot be downgraded in the repository. In fact, this is the only thing which cannot happen. If packages are advanced to newer versions, then we assume that in the process they can change their package relationships in any arbitrary way. So this is, of course, very, very crude. However, this is the only assumption that we could make. There is some leeway possibly here to improve the analysis by giving a more precise, more narrow definition of how these can evolve. But this is open question for me at the moment. So if you have some ideas about this, I would be very keen to discuss this. Okay, so packages can be removed, they can move to newer versions. When packages are changed, they can change their relationships in any way. You can introduce new packages. And this means there are, of course, many, many, many ways how a repository can change. And, well, the consequence of this is that there are potentially infinitely many ways how the repository can change. So this is, of course, a problem if you would like to make this automatic. One remark, at the moment we are assuming that the binary packages in the repository are moving independently of each other. This is, of course, not true, because as we know, packages are uploaded by source packages. But I will come back to this a bit later. Okay, and now we are transforming, we are taking this definition, which is now completely precise, but not effective, and try to turn it into something which is effective. So the first observation is, well, the first question one can ask is, do we have to care about package removals from the repository? And the answer is no, we do not. Why? Well, if it is the case that a package is not installable in any future where we haven't removed packages, then it is never installable in any future. Why? Because the removal of packages from the repository cannot fix installability. It cannot fix anything. So this means that removals of packages are not relevant for us. We can ignore them when we look at all the potential futures of the repository. Okay, next questions. What happens when we introduce now new versions of packages? A priori, these new versions of packages can change the relations in any arbitrary way. Do we really have to care about all these different possibilities, how new packages can change their relations? And the answer is no, again, because for the purpose of this analysis, we can just assume that if we have new versions of packages, then these new versions of packages behave as nicely as you could imagine. They have no dependencies, no conflicts, and they just exist in order to satisfy dependencies of already existing packages. And the reasoning is, well, if a package is installable in the future where all the other packages are as nice as one can imagine, then this package is also installable in all other futures which are potentially worse. So as a result of this, we obtain that we can assume that if we introduce new packages in the repository, then we have no dependencies, no conflicts. And this is, since this is all we care about, this means that we can assume that we know precisely how the future versions of the packages look like. Because we just can say we have no dependencies and no conflicts. Okay, so this is nice. Let's continue. We can also introduce new packages with new names into the repository. Do we have to care about this? Yes, in some sense. Because it may be the case that currently a package is not installable because it declares a dependency of something which currently does not exist. Then obviously, when we introduce this package in the repository, the package becomes installable. So we have to care about potentially new packages, however not about arbitrary new packages. Because new packages can change something only if we already have someone who expresses a dependency on it. So we have to care about new packages, but only about those which names that are already known, which exist already in the dependencies. And this is a set which is known a priori in advance and which is finite. Okay, so this is nice again. So to wrap up what we have up to now, we only have to look at a finite set of new package names, the ones which are already expressed in dependencies. We can ignore package removals, and we can assume for the new packages that we know exactly what they look like. No dependencies, no conflicts. However, there remains one problem, that is the version numbers. And there is, of course, an infinite space of possible version numbers that future versions of packages may assume. And this is the remaining problem that we have to look at. And the way how we solve this is explained quite simply with an example. So assume that we currently have a package P in the repository, say in a version 5. And now we look at all the other dependencies and conflicts. Yeah?
I'm sorry. Yeah? I'm wondering if you can explain again why it's okay to assume that new packages don't have dependencies and conflicts.
Okay.
I can understand that.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
So this was this argument. Okay. Because we are interested in the situation that in all possible futures, a package is not installable. This is the situation that we would like to recognize. Now, in order to recognize this, it is sufficient to look only at those futures where new packages have no dependencies and no conflicts. Because when they have dependencies and conflicts, it makes the installation problem just harder. If it is already impossible, where all the other packages behave as nicely as possible, they don't have themselves any dependencies and conflicts, and they just sit there in order to satisfy my dependencies, and if even in this situation installation is not possible, then I know it's never possible. So that's the reasoning. All right. So the problem that remains is the infinite set of possible versions. Okay, let's look at this example. We have currently package P in version 5. And now I look at all the dependencies and conflicts which are expressed in the other packages in my repository. And say I have a dependency on P in version smaller equals than 9 and P in a version different than 12. Now, the versions that I would have to look at are the following ones. I take the package which I already have in my repository, version 5, and I would introduce future versions that are mentioned in these dependencies 9 and 12. This is, of course, not completely sufficient, because it may also be interesting to look at something which is between these numbers, because otherwise I would miss, for instance, packages that would satisfy some of these combinations of constraints. So in order to obtain really all the possibilities, I would also introduce these red numbers, which are just intermediate points between all the version numbers which are mentioned, plus one, which is bigger than everybody. And I know I don't need anyone version which is smaller than everybody, because I'm only moving forward in the future and never backwards. Okay. So now, in theory, we are almost done. So we have a finite number of version numbers that we would have to care for and which would be representative for all the possible futures that we can obtain. Well, if one looks carefully, one can be a bit better and compress this list a little bit. So here's again what we had on the previous slides. So we have currently version 5, and we have these two constraints, and we have identified this list of versions. Now, what's important about these version numbers is whether they satisfy or not a certain constraint that we have here, smaller equal 9 or different from 12. And when you look at these, you will find that there are two pairs of versions which behave exactly the same with respect to these constraints. In theoretical computer science, this is called an observational equivalence, which means you have a set of observations. They are here. And you identify things for which you cannot observe a difference. And these two pairs are 10 and 13, because when you take 10 and 13, they both do not satisfy this one, and they do satisfy this one, so you can identify them, and I just keep 10 arbitrarily. And also you have 6 and 9, which behave the same, because they do satisfy this one, they also do satisfy this one, so I just keep the version number 9. Okay. So, are we done yet? In theory, yes. In theory, yes. Because,
Why doesn't 5 fall in with 6 and 9 there?
Pardon? Why?
5 seems to satisfy the six same as 6 and 9.
6 and 9, you have smaller and equal, yeah. So 6 and 9, they both do satisfy this constraint.
Right.
And they also both do not satisfy this constraint.
Right, and 5 seems to be in the same category.
Oh, okay, because 5 is in fact the package that we care for. This is the package we currently have in the repository, and this is the package for which we would like to know in the end whether it is installable or not. And the other ones are future versions. The future versions which are introduced here are just future versions that I introduce for the sake of the analysis. Yes, okay. So you're right, okay. So this observational equivalence must be applied only to the future versions. Okay. So what do we get? Now we have, for every package that we have to care about, a finite set of possible future versions. So in theory, we could now look at all the possible combinations and construct all the possible futures. And this is, of course, completely infeasible. Imagine we have 35,000 packages in ZIT. If you only had 2 versions per package, this would give you 2^35,000 possible futures. And believe me, you do not want to compute with that. Okay, so this is completely impossible, even if in theory it would give us an answer. However, the way out of this is quite easy, because what we can do is we take now all the different versions of the packages that we have constructed, plus the ones we have already, and we put them together in one large repository. This would be a repository which contains several versions of packages, but this is something which is perfectly allowed. And we look at this big repository U, which contains everything. Now, this is, of course, much, much smaller. In our example, this would be a small multiple of 35,000, and this is very, very feasible for a SAT solver. Of course, it has to be justified that this gives us exactly the same result with respect to insolubility, but this is the case. And this needs a bit of reasoning, but intuitively it's quite clear, because what we are looking at are all the possible installation sets that are allowed, that are licensed by any of these repositories. And all the possible installation sets that we get from this large, huge repository is exactly the same set as installations at the ones that we get from all these possible futures that we have here. So we just lump together all the versions of the packages, and we look for insolubility in this large set of repositories. No, this would be almost the solution if I wouldn't had if I hadn't made an assumption at the beginning, and this assumption was that all the packages are moving independently of each other, which is not the case in reality. As you know, that binary packages in the repository are advancing in a synchronized way because they are coming from source packages. And when we upload a new version, we upload a new source package, and in our, for the purpose of our analysis, this is like introducing in a cluster new versions of a complete cluster of binary packages. Okay, so this has to be taken into consideration. That is, when we look now at our large universe U, which contains all the future versions of all the packages, then we have to exclude all the installations which would mix versions, different versions of packages coming from the same source. And this is not difficult to do. What we do is we introduce conflicts. And the trick how we did this in our tool is, well, when we have a package of name P and version N, and we find that it comes from a source S called S, then we would just introduce a provides. This package would provide a package that we call source S of version N, and we would say that this package is in conflict with the source S, the same source, but of a different version. And in this way, we would avoid that we install different versions of packages from the same source, but with different versions. There is, of course, I have cheated a little bit. I have cheated at two places. First thing is, we do not really have version provides in Debian. However, when we are doing this analysis, we are no longer working on the Debian format. We are working on a different format, which is called CUDF, which allows to have version provides. First thing. Second thing is, well, this works in case we have binary packages coming from a source package, and all the binary packages coming from the source package have, in fact, the same version. This is not always the case. It might be the case that the maintainer has decided to have one binary package following a completely different version scheme than the rest of them. In reality, our analysis is a bit finer. It just looks at clusters of binary packages which have similar version numbers. And I see that several questions. Yeah. David, Ansgar, maybe you have a... No? David? Yeah.
Once you introduce version provides, then you can actually have packages going backwards in time, because you can introduce a new package that provides an old version number of another package. So your analysis ends up changing once you allow version provides, because you can't guarantee that the version numbering is monotonically increasing.
I do not really follow.
So, okay. Version package foo is at version
Wait,
3.
Excuse me. Of course, I'm assuming that this is a prefix which is not which isn't yet used. So no one is depending on something like source S.
Right. No. So I don't have a problem with this particular step. I'm just pointing out that if your model does allow for version provides, then some of your previous assumptions. If Debian was to suddenly start allowing version provides, then some of your previous assumptions don't hold, because you can introduce a new package that provides a lower version of an existing package.
Okay, good remark. In fact, we are not starting from a model in which we allow version provides. We are starting from the Debian model. And in the Debian model, we only have what Debian policy allows. But then we translate it into CUDF, and we are doing this because our tools are using the CUDF format, and only in this transformed model we are introducing these version provides. Okay, there are some other things one has to look at. For instance, it might be possible that you have a source package and the binary packages generated from the source package have almost the same version number. So it might be that one of them has an epoch, for instance, or it might be the case that one of them has a binmu suffix, but this can be easily dealt with. All right, so and this, in fact, is the solution. This is what our tool is doing. Now let's look at what one gets when one runs this tool on a SIT repository. Yesterday I did it on a recent SIT repository. In that case, it was quite boring. It almost didn't find any outdated packages. This again, I think, is due to the freeze, so all the packages are currently quite well behaved, and for this reason I took an old analysis from October of last year. In that case, we had in Sitmain on I386, we had some 35,000 binary packages, and the classical EDOS step check tool would find among them 431 which are not installable. Now we are running on this our tool, which does this outdated analysis. We are adding new future versions of packages. We call them dummies. And after adding these dummies, we have some 82,000 packages, which is quite a low number. Then our tool runs. It runs for some 2 minutes on my laptop. And it finds among them 119 outdated packages in the sense I just have explained. Now let's look at some of these, what we get. And well, we find among these 119 some 60 which look like this. And you, of course, all, when you are a Debian developer, you have seen these things, you know what this is. This was the Python transition. So this is, in fact, the kind of explanations that we get out of the tool. You find, in this case, that the package with this name and its version number is found to be outdated. And the reason is that it has a dependency which cannot be satisfied. And this dependency is on a Python version smaller than 2.7. Okay, now I know there is a Python transition going on, and this means I would, of course, like to ignore all these reports which are coming from the fact that there is a Python transition going on. How do I do that? Well, I could filter it with grep or something like that, but the proper way to do it now is I just add to my repository a dummy package which just provides Python 2.6 in version, well, Python in version 2.6, and I run my tool again. When I run it again, I get now some 50 packages which are found outdated, and I look again at the results that I get out of this. Well, I get something like this. No, this is really, really an old Python version. So this really is a bug. Okay, and then I think the bug was already reported. I don't remember if it was not. I certainly did report a bug on that. But this was the only one which was still found uninstallable due to a Python dependency. But there are others. So we had some cases like this. In this case, in fact, a package was not installable because the maintainer had, in fact, hardwired into the dependencies a dependency on a package which has already advanced. So here we had a dependency on Asterisk, and we had at that time already a version of Asterisk which was newer than 1.1.8. In this case, this was hardwired into the control file of the package, and this was in fact a bug. Again, this was a bug which was already known at that time. This looks precisely the same. However, the nature is different. Here we have again a package with an unsatisfiable dependency, and of course we have binutils in the archive, but binutils in the newer version like this. However, in this case, this was a dependency which was filled in at build time, and in this case, well, this is kind of a problem for me. If I would like, in fact, I would like to file automatically bug reports out of this. However, for these cases where the dependency is just filled in by compile time, what I should do is, of course, a bug report against FTP. No, it's release, and to ask for rebuild of the package, which I did in this case, but I had to find it out manually by looking at the package. And this finally is an interesting example, and let's look a bit at what happened here. For the first reading, please ignore the blue lines and just look at the black lines and at the red lines. So what happens here? We have a package which is called CyrusAdmin22, which is found to be outdated. And the reason for this is that we have two dependency chains going out from this package, two packages which are themselves in conflict with each other. These two conflicting packages are package 1 and package 2 here. So we have package 1, which is CyrusAdmin24 and CyrusAdmin22. Well, this one is precisely the same as our root package. This one is, in fact, obtained by following a dependency chain. And here in CyrusAdmin24, we have a conflict with CyrusAdmin22. So we have a conflict, and what we have below here, this explains how we arrive at this package. In fact, we have a dependency chain going out from service admin 2.2, our root package, and there we have a dependency on service admin 2.4, and there we arrive at a package which is in a conflict with itself. Okay, so clearly this is not installable. However, according to what I just said, it's not obvious that the package is outdated. Why? We have a conflict, but the conflict is expressed in the package service admin 2.4. So in theory, if the package service admin 2.4 advances to a newer version, which drops this conflict, the problem would be solved. However, this is now where the blue lines kick in. The blue lines tell us that both packages are coming from the same source. They're both coming from service IMAP D2.4, which is a bit strange, but I think these are backward compatibility packages, something like that. Okay, but both are coming from the same source version. And since both are coming from the same source package, they cannot advance independently of each other. And in this case, we know that the maintainer of this package, well, in fact, the maintainer of the source package has to do something about it, and he has to fix his dependency in order to get it right. I think there was some, they tried to do some transitional packages between versions, and they got mixed up with the version numbers. And we filed a bug report about it, and it was fixed immediately. Okay. Now, to wrap up, well, first of all, I should say something about this. So this is a line of research which started a long time ago in 2004. We started with a European research project which was called EDOS. The EDOS project is over since more than 5 years, but somehow this name has stuck with us, and we are still using it as a kind of a brand name because it's now quite well known. So EDOS was the first project on the analysis of a package of package relation, well, where we worked on different aspects of quality assurance of packages. Then we had a Mancusi European project with a slightly different focus. It's all it's also over now, and we are still working on these tools. We are still maintaining these tools. However, we now have changed the names. We are calling them now DOSE, so it's no longer EDOS, it's called DOSE now. We have new implementation of all our tools. We have the tool I just presented to you. It's called Outdated, and you find it in the Debian package of the name DOSE Outdated. And just a brief note of advertisement, we also have a new version of DepCheck, or DisCheck. This has been around since a long time, the old version. We now have a new implementation, which is much better, which has a modular architecture, which has a nice documentation, and which is multi-arc aware. So for Visi, we are still keeping both the old EDOS version and the new DOSE version, but for Visi Plus One, we would like to get rid of the old stuff and just keep the new one, the DOSE stuff. So if you're interested in this, if you're using it, please advance to DOSE, look at it, and talk to me about what you think it. Okay, now what remains to be done? There are some things that I would like to do. Some of them are easy, some of them are not. So it would be nice to have an automatic classification of the results. This would make it much easier for me to file bug reports, because at the moment I file bug reports when I feel like it, when I have the time, and this is not very often recently. So for instance, we get quite some reports about packages which are gruffed. Gruffed means they are still in the archive, but they are no longer generated from the source package. And usually they should be cleaned out by the archive software, but sometimes this doesn't happen. So sometimes we have gruffed, which is found to be non-installable and even outdated. I should find a good way to automatically find packages which just need to be recompiled. And, well, this is a bit more difficult. I also would like to have some way to integrate the information about the officially ongoing transitions. So I know there is a web page by the release team. I just have to find a way to pass this information and to integrate it into the tool which does the classification of the results. Okay, so this is easy stuff. This is just something to implement. What's more interesting, also from an academic point of view, would be precision of the model which is behind the analysis. Because currently we are assuming that all the packages can change in any arbitrary way when they advance to new versions, and this is of course not realistic. However, the challenge is to find a more realistic model. And this model, of course, could not be something like for all the 15,000 source packages I fill in by hand, how these packages can possibly evolve. So what's needed here is some way, some generic model which is realistic and which gives us a better, finer analysis of how packages may evolve. And finally, I also have to work on the explanations, which are currently kind of a mess, and this is due to the output that we get out of the set solver. We have a lot of different alternatives, which has to be taken into account, because we have for every package many different versions that have to be taken into account, and for all possible combinations, the SAT solver gives us an explanation. This gives me a list like this, and currently this is something which I cannot put into a bug report, because otherwise you will kill me. So I have to write by hand an explanation which summarizes the reason why a package is found to be outdated. Okay, thanks for your attention, and I think time is almost up, but maybe there is some time for questions.
Fantastic stuff. Have you considered doing upgradability analysis?
What do you mean by that?
I mean, it seems like your models and much of your software might be able to tell whether, in fact, a system with a particular package installed could be have that package upgraded without needing to deinstall it. I noticed that...
Without needing
to remove it in the meantime. And removing packages in the meantime during an upgrade is undesirable and usually a bug. And I know usually this is the result of bugs in the dependencies. We had one in Woody to Etch, I think it was, where you had to actually, according to the dependencies, you had to remove X during the upgrade.
But then you can...
apt would supply some false options so you didn't notice this.
No, we haven't looked at this so far. In fact, our analysis is somewhat coarse in the sense that we are not really looking at a scheduling of an upgrade. So we are just looking at the original situation, these packages are installed, and at the target situation, these packages are installed, and we are not looking at the sequence of installations that have to be done. I was not aware of, so maybe we can discuss this offline, so I would be very, very interested to learn more about this. Yeah? Thank you.
Have you looked at multi-arc and changes in the relationships that can happen?
Not in the context of this outdated analysis. So the DepCheck tool, the DisCheck tool, is now multi-arc aware. So it knows about dependencies which can be satisfied across architecture boundaries. This outdated analysis, no. I haven't looked at multi-arc, but I do not think, well, I do not hope that it would change the thing in an essential way. Do you think there is a particular problem coming in from multi-arc?
Not that I know.
You're saying no.
No, okay. Okay, good.
Well, thanks, Ralph. If there is no more questions, thanks for your presentation.
Okay, thank you.